Hi students, in this class we are going to discuss Fairani model of economic growth. So this model was developed in 1964 and this model is an extension of Lewis model. It's Lewis model on unlimited supply of labor. So the Fairani's model of economic growth is a dualism model, and in this dualism model we are having two sectors. The one is agricultural sector and the other one is industrial sector. And this model is developed by John C.H. Fay and Gustav Rannes. That is why, because of the association between the Fay, John C.H. Fay and Gustav Rannes, this model is known as Fay-Rannes model. And this is an extension of the Lewis model and also known as surplus labor model. So it's Lewis model or the Fay-Rannes model. All these models are basically based on the excess supply or the unlimited supply of labor. So this model is also known as surplus labor model. Okay, and what does the model suggest? The model suggests that economic development would be taking place if agricultural laborers are transferred to industrial sector where their productivity will increase. Okay, so as per the Fairani's model, which is developed in 1964, which is also an extension of Lewis model, states economic development would be taking place if agricultural laborers are transferred to industrial sector where the productivity is higher or where the productivity will increase. So as per Fairani, if the laborers in the agricultural sector is transferred to the capitalist sector, their productivity will increase, and that's a way the economic development can be attained. Okay, so this model is also based on the surplus labor available in the agricultural sector and how to utilize it in order to attain economic development. So if there is a surplus labor in the agricultural sector, they should be transferred to the industrial sector so that their productivity will increase and thus economic development would be taking place. And the amount of labor that is shifted and the time that this shifting takes place depends on certain aspects. So the model states that there is a necessity or need of shifting laborers from subsistence agriculture to the industrial sector, and when this shift should be taken place and what amount of labor should be shifted is determined based on certain aspects. And now let us see what are those aspects. So as per Fairani's model, the amount of labor that is shifted and the time of shift based on the growth of surplus generated within the agricultural sector and the growth of industrial capital stock dependent on the growth of industrial profit. Okay, so the first thing is the growth of surplus generated within the agricultural sector, and the other one is the growth of the industrial capital stock dependent on the growth of industrial profit. So this is one of the aspect which determines the amount of labor and the time of amount of labor to be shifted and the time when the shift has to be taken place. So growth of the surplus generated in the within the agricultural sector should be considered, and the growth of the industrial capital stock dependent on the growth of industrial profit also need to be considered. Basically, the surplus generated in the agriculture sector and the profit generated in the capitalist sector, all these are factors to determine what amount of labor to be shifted and what time it should be shifted. The next one is the nature of the industry's technical progress. So based we know that technical progress changes from time to time. So the nature of the industry's current technical progress is another determinant which decides the amount of labor to be shifted. So based on the nature of the technical progress, the amount of labor or the time of labor to be shifted is determined. The next one is the growth rate of population. So here we have another important aspect, the growth rate of population, which also have a key role. Okay, so growth of the surplus generated in the agriculture sector, the growth of the industrial capital stock dependent on the industrial profit, growth of the population, and nature of the technical progress. These are the aspects that decides what amount of labor to be shifted from the agriculture sector to the industrial sector, or at what time the shift has to be taken place. And the three fundamental ideas used in this model are: agricultural growth and industrial growth are both equally important. So here You know that when we studied the Lewis model, we have discussed that is a dual model where economic growth take place, or the growth is based where growth is possible when the modern sector is given with more importance, or the modern sector output generation should be more related to the subsistence sector, then only the growth will be attained. That is what we have discussed in Lewis model. And here the three fundamental ideas used in this model are, they are considering both the agricultural and industrial sector are equally important, both are equally important, and they also say that agricultural growth and industrial growth are balanced also. Okay, here when we come to the Ferrari's model, both the agricultural and industrial growth are equally important and both of them are balanced, and only if, so this is important point, the fundamental idea used in the model, only if the rate at which labor is shifted from the agriculture to the industrial sector is greater than the rate of growth of population, then the economy will be able to lift itself from the Malthusian population trap. Okay, so here both agricultural and industrial sector are equally important and balanced, and only if the rate of shift of agricultural labors to the industrial sector is greater than the rate of growth of population, only at that stage the economy will be able to lift themselves up from the Malthusian population trap. So what is Malthusian population trap? That means because of the excess population, the growth of the excess population has been stopped, or this growth of the population is not possible because of the food shortage or lack of supply of the food. So that is Malthusian population trap. That means the excess population growth is not being made possible because of the food shortage. So that is Malthusian population trap. And here it is stated that only if the rate of shift, the rate of labor which has been shifted from the agricultural to the industrial sector is greater than the growth of population, only in that case the economy can be lifted themselves up from the Malthusian population trap. If the rate of growth of population is more than the shift, then that will keep the economy in the situation of population trap, Malthusian population trap. It cannot be, it cannot help the economy to revive from the Malthusian population trap. So how, as per the Ferrari's, if the rate of growth of, rate of shift of labor from the agriculture to the industrial sector is greater than the rate of growth of population, then it will help the economy to revive from the Malthusian population trap. So the growth tool, when we take the Ferrari's model, the growth tool is the generation of agricultural surplus. That means through commercialization, it is necessary to create agricultural surplus, or to necessary to generate agricultural surplus through commercialization, and that can be one of the growth tool when it comes to the Ferrari's model. So through the commercialization, agricultural surplus can be generated, and that can be used as a growth tool. Now we are moving on to the three stages of Ferrari model. So here we have first stage where marginal productivity is zero, second stage where average productivity is greater than the marginal productivity, and third stage where marginal productivity is greater than the constant institutional wage. So these are the three stages of the Ferrari model. We'll go one by one. So the first stage where marginal productivity is zero is similar to the, or just say exactly as same as the Lewis model of unlimited supply of labor. So we know that in Lewis model, the shift from the subsistence sector to the modern sector or the capitalist sector take place when the marginal productivity of agricultural labor or the subsistence sector labors is zero. So similarly here also, the first stage is similar to the Lewis, and discouraged unemployment comes into being because the supply of labor is perfectly elastic and marginal productivity of labor is equal to zero. So we know that discouraged unemployment means, that means the marginal productivity is zero. There is no excess output generation, or there is no change in the marginal product because of the effort of a labor, then that is discouraged unemployment. So discouraged unemployment comes into being because the supply of labor is perfectly elastic, at the same time the marginal productivity is zero, and therefore such discouraged unemployment ought to be transferred to the industrial sector at the constant institutional wage. So what the first stage is similar to the Lewis model, that is marginal productivity is equal to zero, and here there is discouraged unemployment, and discouraged unemployment is coming into being because of the supply of labor is perfectly elastic and marginal productivity is equal to zero. When there is such kinds of disguised unemployment, those disguisedly unemployed agricultural laborers need to be shifted to the industrial sector. At what condition? At the constant institutional wage. So that is the first stage. Second stage is where agricultural workers are to agricultural output, but they produce less than the institutional wage they get. So when we are considering the agricultural workers, so whatever output they are generated is basically they are adding it to the agricultural output, but the output they generate is less than the institutional wage that they receive. So that means the average productivity is greater than the marginal productivity. Okay, so the output generated is less than the institutional wage. In such cases, it is understood that the average productivity is equal greater than marginal productivity. So in the second stage, the labor surplus exists where average productivity of labor is greater than marginal productivity of labor. That means the output generated by the laborers is less than the institutional wage they receive or they get. So since the average productivity of labor is greater than the marginal productivity of labor, but it is not equal to the subsistence wages. Okay, so that when AP greater than MP means average productivity of labor is greater than the marginal productivity of labor, and in these cases this is not equal to the institutional wage. The output they generated is less than the wages they receive or wages they get, so that is not equal to the institutional wage. So accordingly, disguised unemployed also have to be transferred to the industrial sector. So we are basically mentioning the reasons why the surplus labor from the agriculture sector need to be transferred to the industrial sector. Initially we told there is disguised unemployment where marginal productivity is equal to zero, and because of that reason there is a need of transferring the surplus labor from agriculture to the industrial sector. Okay, and second reason we are mentioning that average productivity of labor is greater than the marginal productivity of labor, and but it is not equal to the institutional wage they receive, because the output generated by a worker is less than the institutional wage they receive. So there is a requirement of shifting labors of excess labor of the agricultural sector to the industrial sector. So accordingly, the disguised unemployed have to be transferred to industrial sector. Moving on to the third phase. So third phase is the prominent one where marginal productivity is greater than constant institutional wage. So this is the take-off situation. Okay, when the third stage of Fairani's model, the take-off situation comes to an end, and there begins the era of self-sustained growth where the farm workers produce more than the institutional wage they get. So when we comes to the third stage, this is end to the take-off stage, and there it begins another era where the self-sustained growth is beginning. Okay, from the take-off stage, the beginning of there starts the beginning of a new era. That new era is self-sustained growth, and at that stage what happens? Marginal productivity is greater than constant institutional wage, where the farm workers produce more than the institutional wage they get. So just the second phase we told that the production is less than the institutional wage, that is why AP greater than MP. But when we come to the third phase, it begins an era of sustained growth, and it is end to the takeoff and beginning to the self-sustained growth era. So at that time, the institutional wage they receive, the output is more than the wage they receive. So the farmers are working and their output is more than the institutional wage they get. That means marginal productivity is greater than constant institutional wage. So in this stage, economic growth, the surplus labor comes to an end, and agricultural sector becomes commercialized sector. So initially we told what the growth tool is, the through the agricultural generation of the agricultural surplus can be considered as a growth tool. Generation of the agricultural surplus is a growth tool in Fairani's model. So in the third stage, with the beginning of the self-sustained growth, when the marginal productivity of labor is greater than the constant institutional wage, there comes an end to the surplus labor situation. There exists no more surplus labor, and so this stage, the economic growth, surplus labor comes to an end, and the agricultural sector, whatever the output of the agricultural surplus, that can be used for the commercial purposes. So thus, through the generation of the agricultural surplus, through these various stages, the economic growth can be attained by and this is the model developed by the Fairani's. Okay, so three stages. First was marginal productivity is equal to zero. there discussed unemployment is there, therefore the shift is needed. Second, average productivity is greater than the marginal productivity, there the output is less than the institutional wage. But by the third stage, it's a stage where an end of the takeoff stage and beginning of the self-sustained. At that point, what happened is the economy is basically attaining, the economy is in a position where marginal productivity is greater than the constant institutional wage. The output of the worker is more than the wages they receive. So at this point, economy is at a point of development, or the economy is at a point where economic growth is attained. There is no surplus labor and the end of the surplus labor. So this agricultural sector is becoming a commercialized sector. When agricultural sector is becoming a commercialized sector, there comes the economic development. Okay. So this is the Fail-Rannis model of economic growth. So now let us discuss the previous year questions from Fail-Rannis model. There are few questions asked on this model. So this one, there was asked in 2017 Jan, paper 3, question number 22. Fail-Rannis theory of economic development is based on, first option, dualistic approach to development. Second option, presence of disguised unemployment. Third option, importance of agricultural development. And fourth option, all of the above. Here the answer is all of the above, because we know that the Fail-Rannis theory of development was put forward by Fail-Rannis, the two economists, and they have presented the economy in a dualistic approach itself. So there is the both agricultural sector and industrial sector. As per them, the economy is consisting of two sectors. One is agricultural sector, another one is industrial sector. So that therefore the first point, the dualistic approach to development, is correct. The second one, the presence of disguised unemployment. We know that when we discussed the three stages, the first stage was MP equal to 0, where there is disguised unemployment, and when there is disguised unemployment, it is required to shift the excess supply of labor from the agricultural sector to the industrial sector. So the point, the presence of disguised unemployment, is also correct with respect to Fail-Rannis theory. Third one, importance of agricultural development. So when we were discussing the growth tool of the Fail-Rannis model, it was generating the agricultural surplus. So generation of the agricultural surplus was considered as a growth tool of Fail-Rannis development. Therefore, the importance of agricultural development is also related to Fail-Rannis theory. So all the three points given are directly related to the Fail-Rannis theory of economic development, and all of the above will be the answer. Option 4 is the answer. Next question, 2017 Jan, paper 3. Which among the following has not given his model based on the concept of unlimited supply of labor? We have three options: D.W. Jorgensen, Rannis Fay, W.L. Lewis, and Gunnar Myrdal. So out of this, we have to identify who among these is not related to, or whose model is not based on the concept of unlimited supply of labor. We have seen these questions when we studied the unlimited supplies of labor, and when we discussed the previous equation based on Lewis theory of unlimited supply of labor. And here the answer will be Gunnar Myrdal, because when we take Lewis, he is the one who has put forward the Lewis theory of unlimited supply of labor, where he used the concept of unlimited supply of labor. When we came to Rannis Fay, Fail-Rannis is otherwise the extension of the Lewis model, and there also mentioned about the surplus labor which has been generated in the agricultural sector need to be shifted to the industrial sector. So he has quoted the importance of surplus labor in the in his concept. And moving on to D.W. Jorgensen, even he also used the concept of surplus labor. He has rejected the idea of Lewis theory of unlimited supply of labor. At the same time, he assumes surplus labor exists in rural areas, and in urban areas there is full employment. So the concept of surplus labor was even used by Jorgensen. So Lewis, Fail-Rannis, and Jorgensen are the economists who have used the concept of surplus labor in their models, and whereas Gunnar Myrdal is nowhere related, nowhere connected the concept of surplus labor in his models. Therefore, the one economist who is not related to the concept of unlimited supply of labor will be Gunnar Myrdal. Okay, whereas all the other three are related to the concept of unlimited supply of labor. So answer will be 4, that is Gunnar Myrdal. Okay, these are the two questions from the Fail-Rannis model. So this model is an extension of the Lewis model, as I have already mentioned. So there are similar concepts being discussed in both the models. So it's very important from the examination point of view. Thank you.